Recorded Books presents The Poisons We Drink by Bethany Baptiste, narrated by Lynnette R. Freeman.
I dedicate this book to all my haters. I only got this far out of spite. A quote commonly attributed to Nelson Mandela and others, resentment is like drinking poison and then hoping it will kill your enemies. Content warning. Please be aware that this book contains morally gray characters, complicated parent-child relationships, police brutality, fantasy violence, fantastical racism, magical coercion, gun violence, politics, parental death, child death, and dying/death. In addition, there are depictions of post-traumatic stress disorder, anxiety, and depression. Other content warnings include self-harm, such as needles for finger pricking, and daggers for palm splitting to perform spells, blood and gore, sexual situations, real and fantasy drugs, underage drinking, and profanity. Please be mindful of these topics and triggers. Self-care is essential if you're sensitive to any of the above. Chapter 0. A quote from Candace Joyner, a Witcher journalist for the Societal Mirror. An internal gift exists within all breathing things to recognize where one stands in the food chain. Witchers are what humans could have been, but according to scientists, a missing link in the evolutionary chain sent the two species in separate directions. However, magic doesn't make witchers superior to humans. For what humans lack in magic, they make up for it with something even more dangerous. Power. June 4th, 2023. He shouldn't have come here. He stopped just past the doorway's mouth, squinting his aging eyes behind his thick spectacles. Even in the dark, he sensed them all weighing his worth. Witchers. The old man gulped, his heart doubling in pace. A row of 13 light bulbs dangled above the bar and aimed a spotlight on a dark-skinned black man enjoying a wood-tipped cigarillo. He had fine dreadlocks woven into two thick braids. A white bar towel swirled across the counter's marred surface without a single hand to aid it.
Good evening, sir,
the old man stammered. The bartender's closed eyelids didn't twitch or peel up at the pathetic greeting.
I have an appointment with...
The old man swept his eyes for eavesdroppers, lowering his voice to a whisper.
Prospero.
The bartender brought the cigarillo to his lips for another draw. Two puffs of wispy gray rushed out his nostrils and muddled together in a cloud. His eyelids opened to unveil cold, dark irises. The old man shrank back as the bartender planted his hands on the counter and leaned in.
Does it look like I'm a fucking receptionist?
His teeth clenched the polished wood tip. The dull golden light revealed his muscular arms and the inked rattlesnake on his right forearm. The old man shook his head quickly, not at the question, but in disbelief, as the snake moved. Before his brain could properly process the sight, the tattoo snapped forward as if to strike. He stumbled backward, earning the bartender's deep-chested chuckle.
Don't be so mean, Bram,
an Indian-American woman said, feigning disappointment as she sat on a nearby bar stool. The lime-green parakeet perched on her shoulder, so still that he might have mistaken it for a toy, until it turned its head to stare him down.
Its eyes glowed and flickered like embers as it scrutinized him before the incandescence petered out. A familiar. Taking flight, it glided across the bar area, disappearing through the mouth of a corridor. The woman shot him a charming smile as she lifted her whiskey glass to her lips, ice clanking inside the confined sea of dark liquor.
You weren't there a moment ago, he said, his tone full of self-doubt.
A sudden ache of confusion pulsed in his head. The woman winked as she placed her tumbler down, tracing stiletto-nailed fingertips around the rim. I'm a bit of an opportunist for making fashionable entrances, she said. I'm sure a gentleman such as yourself understands that. The old man stuttered.
I'm not one for fashionable entrances.
And though he was more than eager to make an unfashionable retreat, he understood it was too late for that now. He was too deep in a lion's den to scurry away like a mouse. She giggled at his expense. No need to be ashamed, she assured. We won't judge. Bram snorted his disagreement.
I judge.
The woman ignored the bartender's comment. Our mutual friend sent me here to collect you, Mr. Mouse, the old man sputtered. A human's true name had more worth than money in dealings such as these. Mr. Mouse, it is then, she said, nodding once.
And what might I call you?
He asked, hesitant. She downed the rest of her drink in one go and uncrossed her legs. Her silk ruched gown, the color of plums, rippled as she slid off the barstool. Nisha, she replied, her finger beckoning him. Now please, follow me. Mr. Mouse trailed behind her and kept his attention on her head of loose, inky black curls curtaining down her back, too afraid to lock eyes with other witchers not as kind as the one in front of him. He didn't consider them animals, but they scrutinized his movements like predators.
Good luck,
Bram said.
You'll need it.
Nisha guided him down a hallway, leading him past an odd fixture, a wooden phone booth. The sight made his eyebrows scrunch together. In a thriving age of wild youth and technology, that phone booth didn't belong. It was a relic of another time. Like him. An old testament to a world that died when the new millennium took its first breaths and witchers willingly made themselves known to humans. The Great Discovery. That's what historians coined that period, when the truth split society at the seams. The metallic creak of rusted hinges reeled him back to the present, the door yawning to reveal the manager's office, filled with a mighty mahogany desk, quilted leather chairs, and an imposing bookshelf brimmed with dangerous knowledge. His escort rounded the desk and leaned down to whisper in the ear of their mutual friend. A slow turn revealed a man in his late 20s with green hair parted and slicked back. His sepia eyes had a weary wisdom to them, as if he were the oldest thing here. Prospero's lip quirked up at the old man's arrival. Please.
Come in and join us, Mr. Mouse,
Prospero said, gesturing to an empty seat before his grand desk.
I won't eat you.
He already ate, Nisha quipped, remaining at her employer's side. Mr. Mouse peered from beyond the doorway before he complied. He jerked his head around, startled as the door creaked shut on its own. Timid steps led him to a quilted leather seat, his spine as straight and rigid as a steel rod.
Very few humans have the nerve to walk into the golden coin and utter aloud a name many fear. I commend you for your bravery, Prospero said.
I'm not brave, Mr. Mouse said urgently. I'm desperate.
A dreadful cough crawled up his lungs and throat. He emptied it into his arm's crook. When the fit passed, he swallowed bloody spit like a bitter coppery pill.
It's not impossible to be both, Prospero returned as Mr. Mouse caught his breath. But I understand that time is of the essence for you and your delicate situation. However, I assume you have my fee before we begin this consultation.
Yes,
Mr. Mouse wheezed out. His shaky hand yanked the meaty envelope from his jacket's pocket, dropping it onto the desk. Nisha's sharp nail opened it with a surgical slice. A melody of rustling paper filled the office as the crisp $100 bills traveled through a counting machine. A pleased smile etched her mouth. Prospero snapped his fingers, and a crude gold coin materialized in his hand. The coin swayed as it rose and rolled across his palm.
There are many options to choose from, but all come at a cost.
Money isn't an issue,
Mr. Mouse said, his unexpected boldness surprising himself. He softened his tone, his stiff backbone relaxing as if he were indeed among friends and not natural enemies.
I have enough of it. Had enough of it. It won't help. I've accepted that.
The coin stilled on Prospero's pale knuckles.
Then what is it you desire?
I want...
Mr. Mouse hesitated as his old sin surfaced like faded scars and peeled open to bleed out guilt and regret.
I want love from someone that no longer wants anything to do with me.
Prospero chuckled, softly at first, then louder until the sound melted away and the only evidence of his amusement was the widening ancient smile of a trickster.
You passed a phone booth in the hallway. It's home to the black book, a phone book for every need and greed you desire. Step inside and search for the love witcher,
he instructed, flicking the coin. Mr. Mouse's fumbling hands reached out to catch it, but it halted midair, directly in front of his face. His cheeks burned with embarrassment as he grabbed it. Tiny vibrations of magic soaked into his fingertips, bloodstream and bones. He felt lightheaded and liberated all at once as he grasped the key to his problems.
Thank you, Prospero.
He bowed his head as he got up, feeding off the sudden energy surging through his veins. Was this what hope felt like? The door immediately opened for him. Prepared to leave, he froze at Nisha's voice.
Be careful, Mr. Mouse, Nisha said. The love you seek will glitter like gold to draw you in, but it's nothing more than a mirage, and mirages always fade. If love is what you desire, a familiar's love and loyalty are unconditional.
She folded her arms on the chair's crest.
I can summon the perfect one for you.
In search of hers, he glanced around the office.
If they're so loyal, where's yours?
A soft smirk of mischief curved her lips.
Oh, he's around.
Briefly, Mr. Mouse considered the offer of a magical companion, but his heart refused to budge. He wagged his head, turning to leave.
when you've done the things I've done and seen the things I've seen, a mirage is a welcome change. Pretending gives a comfort I don't deserve.
As he exited the office and the door began to shut behind him, Prospero said,
"As long as you know it for what it is."
Mr. Mouse did, and he always would. He entered the phone booth. A fat, leather-bound telephone book waited for him. Peeling back the cover, he dove into a world of advertisements and lofty-priced promises glowing like stars against the black pages. His eyes combed hungrily, searching for any mention of a love witcher in a bewildering sea of witchery trades he didn't understand. He huddled over the monstrous book, sweat glistening on his brow. His heartbeat throbbed in his achy, tight throat.
"There,"
Mr. Mouse blurted, jabbing a fingertip at the full-page ad with a border of pulsing hearts. He found it. A trembling hand brought a phone to his ear as he jammed a coin into a slot and dialed.
"How did you get this number?"
The answerer's sharp words possessed a heavy accusatory air, inducing his guilt before he even dared to open his mouth.
"From the Black Book? I need your expertise."
"And what expertise do you think it is?"
This call was dangerous. They both knew it.
"Love,"
he uttered. He suffered a long, painful pause. Finally, she spoke.
"I'm listening."
Chapter 1. A quote from the Witcherpedia, an online witchery encyclopedia. A negative empath can detect, feel, and sometimes even feed on others' negative moods, emotions, and temperaments. However, this ability can be unpredictable. Both strong and subtle emotions might occasionally go undetected. Despite its inconsistencies, the negativity from others can cause the negative empath either pain or pleasure. And for magical adepts, it can even amplify their power temporarily. June 5th, 2023. Venus Stoneheart didn't need to read Mr. Lionel's mind to know he couldn't stand her ass. All the things he wanted to do and say to her broadcasted loudly in his glare as they stood on their respective sides of the street. His hatred for her swept across her skin like a tide of pinpricks.
"Good morning, Mr. Lionel."
He wrinkled his nose in disgust, hawking a wad of spit in her direction. The glob splattered onto the street, glistening like a hideous jewel. He greeted her with this when he moved in 3 weeks ago. His first attempt promptly dribbled down his chin. The sight made her bite her inner cheek until she tasted blood to hold in all her laughter. Every morning since, they bound themselves in this odd morning ritual. Venus believed it was rewarding to help him get better at something. She also had a running bet with her uncle and little sister that she could get the old man to spit in the shallow pothole 2 feet and 7 inches from his curb. Today he was about a foot off. She refrained from congratulating him on his new improvement as he straightened the skewed iron watch signage on his front yard. An emblem of witcher hatred. Deanwood, a witcher enclave in Northeast DC, had its fair share of vacant houses. Several were abandoned by witchers who fled to California or Canada for safety. Some families got forced out by banks or landlords. That was the case for the family that once lived in the house Mr. Lionel now owned. Like most gentrifiers, he probably thought being here would help clean up the neighborhood. But Deanwood didn't need cleaning. It wasn't dirty. When she blew him a kiss, his hatred sharpened against her skin, pinpricks intensifying to jabs as punishment. In her robe's pocket, she clenched a fist at the pain. Some empaths could feel everyone's everything. Others could only sense shades of happiness or the depths of confusion. As for Venus, the universe played in her face by making her a magnet for negative emotions. A beacon for anger, fear, hate, and worse, to find their way out of the dark. Having had enough, Mr. Lionel shuffled back to the porch with his newspaper and slammed his iron-barred door shut. Iron, a witcher's natural enemy, kept him safe. She relaxed as the link between them severed. "Good morning to you too," Venus muttered, swirling on her bunny slippers to go back inside. Her cousin Tyrell snored loudly on the living room couch, belly up and head dangling off the cushion edge. She strolled into the kitchen, claiming her usual spot at the table. Her half-awake uncle entered right after her, wearing his ribbed tank top, basketball shorts, and the satin robe. His slippers slapped the tile floor with every step. Occasionally, he'd crash here after all-night shifts, using exhaustion as an excuse not to drive 5 miles south to Anacostia. Though he wouldn't admit it, his real reason was loneliness. "Hey, Uncle Bram," she greeted, slipping the newspaper out of its thin plastic sleeve. He shot her a tired grin.
"Morning, Pinky."
She rolled her eyes at the nickname, alluding to her cotton candy pink dye job. A fresh batch of Morning Joe waited in the coffee maker. At Uncle Bram's doing, invisible hands prepared 2 mugs and carried them toward the table. He trailed right behind the cups, spiking his coffee with a splash from his trusty flask. She combed through shiny sheets of grocery coupons and sales, always searching for things she needed for her main hustle. All the while, her pastel purple mug found its way to her. Uncle Bram nodded his gratitude as she offered up the newspaper she had no use for. A comfortable silence fell between them until one of Tyrell's gurgling snores reached the kitchen. Uncle Bram brought his mug to his lips, but paused at the sound. He arched a thick eyebrow at her.
"Again?"
"Again. As in, after another fight with his mom. Tyrell decided to claim their couch as his for a few days." "Yep," she answered, shrugging. Uncle Bram took his first sip, his eyes bulging as he rattled out a cough. Acute concern edged her voice. "You okay?" He blinked away tears as he let out a wheezy chuckle.
"Yeah, this is good stuff. It's waking my ass up."
"Nah, sounds like it's beating your ass." Venus drew in her brows, unconvinced. Janus, her younger sister, dragged herself through the back door, looking like a cross between roadkill and a hangover personified. Her mane of ombre gray curls was a frizzy mess. Smudged mascara adorned her eyes. The loose blue crop top she wore had questionable stains. Venus closed her eyes briefly, relief whispering through her. Then she went for a sip. "Good to know you didn't die last night." "Translation? Thanks for not returning any of my texts, you bitch." "It's not my time to go yet," Janus croaked. She stole the mug from Venus's hands and gulped from it boldly. "Oh, thanks for the coffee, V. No problem at all, Jay," Venus said, feigning annoyance to disguise her amusement.
"I'll say thank you for the coffee after I drink it all,"
Janus replied matter-of-factly as she plopped into her designated spot and propped up her glittery Converse sneakers. Uncle Bram brushed her feet off the table and she whimpered in protest. Another loud snore from the living room garnered Janus's attention. She blinked.
"Again?"
"Again," Venus and Uncle Bram chorused. Then their uncle eyed Janus over the edge of his newspaper.
"Since you made it back in one piece, I suppose it's safe to assume the Swigs didn't raid your little party.
Swigs, an acronym for Security for Witchers in Gathering, was the name of an iron-armed police tactical response unit. The law prohibited witchers from holding social assemblies or occupying public establishments in gatherings of 13 or more. And to enforce said law, the Swigs used brutal tactics to bring witchers in or take them down. Venus no longer had an appetite for parties. Parties, no matter the size, seemed too intimate for her now. Too many bodies and emotions in one confined place made her claustrophobic. Aside from dodging iron bullets and avoiding arrest, a raid was the worst place for somebody like her. A breeding ground for negative emotions as witchers ran for their lives and Swigs took lives, only adding more oxygen to a fire bottled up inside her. A fire that ached to be an inferno. If it broke free, everyone was fucked.
Yep, different party.
Janus hid her smug smile as she drank more coffee.
Not that it matters anyway. I'm pretty sure I'd get away without breaking a sweat.
3 years ago, she could barely open a portal to go two streets over. Now she could go to familiar places within a city radius and open a doorway as quickly as twisting a doorknob. Uncle Bram frowned, lowering his newspaper.
Don't get cocky, Jay. All it takes is a split second for a swagger to pull a trigger while you're trying to summon a doorway. Callings aren't bulletproof.
All witchers possessed two things, a birthright and a calling. A birthright was innate magic typical to all witchers, but callings were unique abilities awoken on 13th birthdays. No one truly knew how many callings were out there, though. Some were common or hereditary, and others were rare. Each had its struggles and limitations that only time or luck could sort out. Uncle Bram could crush bones and lift cars with his superior strength, so he kept his touch gentle, used his magic to handle things his hands couldn't, and avoided giving hugs. Sometimes he even enchanted fragile possessions he found joy in, so they wouldn't break, like his coffee mug and flask. Tyrell inherited shape-shifting from his mom. For him, change brought nothing but pain, so he preferred to be himself, even if bodily urges wanted the opposite for him. As for Venus, sensing emotions was only the iceberg tip of her calling. Janus pursed her lips.
I'm better than you think, Uncle B.
I ain't doubting that, but someone out there will always be better than you at something.
Uncle Bram said,
for us, it's humans that like aiming guns loaded with iron bullets.
Janice darted her eyes over to Venus as a silent petition for support. Uncle B's right. The Swigs are busting too many parties. I don't think it'll kill you to be a homebody until everything cools down. After saying her piece, Venus noticed the subtle wince of betrayal glitch across Janice's face. Guilt sat heavy in her stomach, forcing her to revert her attention to the coupon pages. Janice snorted a bitter laugh as she stood.
I'm sorry if I'm not scared shitless by humans.
Venus cast her gaze to the kitchen ceiling, her lips crimping in slight irritation. Not enough caffeine was in her system to deal with this back and forth, but she set the record straight anyway. I'm not scared of them either, Jay. I just know what they're capable of.
If humans do terrible things, then why do you work for them and take their money, Venus?
Though delivered as a question, Janice's words felt like an answer and opinion all rolled into one. To pay the bills. Electricity, food, and clothes aren't free. Without money, you wouldn't have a home to stumble into, hungover and looking like a hot mess. Venus levied a play with it if you want to glare at her sister.
Uncle Bram mouthed the word, "Damn." Then their mom, Clarissa, entered the kitchen. Long brown micro locks spilled from her high ponytail, framing her oval face. She wore a red t-shirt and mom jeans ironed to perfection. Her 7-year-old white sneakers looked brand new. Already ready for the day.
"Janus, shouldn't you be trying to recover properly from your nightly escapades?"
she asked coolly.
"Ma'am, yes, ma'am."
Janus gave a 2-finger salute and departed, taking along the stolen coffee. Venus felt a foreign annoyance flare up in her rib cage. Janus's annoyance. Her sister invaded the living room and sat crisscross before the flat screen, hiking up the volume obnoxiously loud. A tiny act of rebellion everyone else ignored.
"A potential client called last night,"
Clarissa said, fixing herself a cup.
"How did he get our number?" Venus asked.
"Prospero,"
Uncle Bram answered, his magic turning a page. Clarissa claimed her seat at the head of the table.
"I'm assuming you've met him?"
she asked her older brother, mild intrigue tinging her tone.
"He came into the bar last night, looking for Prospero. Nisha had a bit of fun beforehand,"
Uncle Bram said, shaking his head.
"He insisted on being called Mr. Mouse."
Venus restrained her snicker. With an alias like that, the dude was asking to be played with. She cleared her throat.
"And how did that work out for him, Uncle B?"
He whistled, hiking his eyebrows.
"I'm surprised he didn't faint. I'm sure Prospero didn't mind one bit. That finder's fee of 10 grand will probably go toward his expensive-ass wardrobe."
"I don't mind either,"
Clarissa said.
"Clients like him are the best. They'll pay just about anything to get what they want."
She smirked, resting her elbows on the table.
Venus didn't blame her mother for searching for silver linings. Money made shit a little easier to swallow, but running an illegal operation was tricky and deadly. Once, Clarissa was the love witcher, but her greed backfired and sent her to early retirement. For a long time, their family struggled until Venus was old enough to help. After all, bills didn't pay themselves. Venus hustled as a brewer, a maker of potions. Brewing possessed more risks than rewards, resulting in a near-dead trade. Human fairy tales and movies always depicted misconceptions about brewing. Tossing a few oddly named ingredients into a bubbling cauldron and chanting a spell didn't equal a voila. Brewing required a price. Brewing demanded a pain so excruciating that if you lived, you'd wish you died. The culprit was called the degree of recoil, a potion's chemical blowback. Brewing was a fatal art, but doing what she did helped keep her calling at bay.
"Are you thinking about me, sweet girl?"
A croaky voice breezed into her mind's depths.
"Go away,"
she whispered into the dark of her mind, sounding so meek and unsure, she immediately hated herself for it.
"Venus Genevieve, are you listening?"
Her mother's words sliced through her thoughts. Venus blinked, startled for a moment. She made a quick recovery, but steeled herself far too late. Though Uncle Bram gave her a concerned look, she dreaded her mother's critical regard, always trying to find a crack in her foundation, always in search of a glimmer of weakness, no matter how minuscule. Clarissa cradled her world's best mom mug, clicking a manicured fingernail on the porcelain.
"Did you take your reinforcement potion this morning?"
The question hung in the air like a rancid odor, and Venus wrinkled her nose accordingly.
"Venus!"
Clarissa drawled out the syllables in the way only disappointed mothers could.
"You promised to be more consistent.
I'm sorry if it wasn't on my mind before my first cup of coffee.
Venus massaged her temple as a headache wafted in.
It should be. We can't leave anything to chance.
Her mother's anger crept in slow, snaking around Venus's limbs and tightening ever so slightly.
I don't think the world will end if I don't take it right now.
Would it be so bad if it did?
The voice whispered to her and only her.
Shut the hell up!
Venus ordered within herself, adding more boom and authority to the command, which pleased her.
I guess we'll never know, because that's exactly what you're about to do.
Clarissa marched to the fridge and slung open the door, retrieving a polished oak box with a golden buckle lock. She withdrew a corked glass vial brimmed with fluid the color of crushed mulberries, muttering about low supply. As Clarissa's hand delivered it, resentment burned in Venus's chest.
How does it feel to know your own mother doesn't trust us?
The voice taunted.
Do you even trust me?
The word us singed her tongue's tip, and she bit down hard as a tiny punishment to herself.
I don't trust it,
Clarissa replied, holding out the vial. Such a simplistic, deceiving name for her deviation. Sentient parasitic magic that imposed will as it sought fit. And as its host, she was a deviant, merely a vessel to administer and infect. Most witchers could not bend another's will without the help of a potion, but for the rare, unfortunate few, like Venus, swaying, bending, and breaking a prey's volition was as easy as breathing. To be a deviant meant she and it were dangerous and unpredictable, especially when it made others want to hurt each other, and worse, much, much worse. Her mother and Uncle Bram peered at her intently as she took the vial, watching her as if she were an animal expected to do a trick.
So pathetic. Go on. Show both of them how you're such a good girl.
It taunted. Venus uncorked the vial, guzzling swiftly. The reinforcement potion slithered down her throat like curdled milk, tainting her taste buds with an awful combo of citrus and copper. She coughed violently, tears swelling in her eyes. Her stomach lurched with a wave of nausea. Hugging her belly, she hunched forward. Her body trembled as the potion seeped into the fabric of her being to reinforce a cage for it. It quieted down, but she still sensed it like a secondary heartbeat, steady and unwavering. A constant reminder it would die when she did.
As I was saying, Mr. Mouse will schedule a pickup at the usual spot. Techie'll meet him beforehand as your buffer.
Clarissa resumed. Are you listening? A terrible ringing echoed in Venus's ears. She barely heard her mother underneath it, muffled but understandable, as if her head were underwater.
Yes,
Venus rasped out.
Oh, and we're out of...
A fed-up Uncle Bram growled,
Risa, shut the hell up for a minute. Give the girl some time to recover.
Clarissa exhaled sharply.
She'll be fine. The effects will wear off in 2 minutes.
That ain't the point.
He rose to offer Venus his coffee as a chaser, an ineffective method for washing away the harsh residue of magic that coated her throat. But she appreciated the gesture.
Thanks, Uncle V.
Venus croaked, gathering her strength to take a great gulp. His eyes cut over to his younger sister, and he requested tightly.
I want to talk to you for a sec.
Clarissa's narrowed eyes locked with his, her thinning patience matching his, but she stood nonetheless. They both exited through the back door. Venus didn't need to be a fly on the wall to know the topic of discussion unfolding outside. Clarissa's love was odd and jagged. It never quite fit as it should, but there was no other place for it to go. Uncle Bram argued with her about it, hoping his words would sand down hers, but it never worked. Her mother's love was here to stay, too embedded in her chromosomes to evolve. After the potion's side effects subsided, Venus tested the strength of her legs and wobbled toward the living room as Janus flipped through the channels while Tyrell snored. A beautiful older Afro-Latina anchor stared dead straight at them. Believed to be the latest victim in a string of murders plaguing D.C., bringing the body toll to 10 witchers. During a press conference, the chief of police asked for patience from the witcher community during this ongoing investigation. This prompted a response from the Witchers Against Species Persecution co-founder Malik Jenkins. Janice's slumped spine perked up at the mention of her dad. She untangled her crossed legs and crawled a little closer to the screen, engrossed as the segment played snippets of his response video.
We will continue to fight for equality for witchers and
humans. Malik was going to say humans, but the video switched seamlessly to another incomplete statement that fit just as well. Venus rolled her eyes at that, gripping the couch's cushioned arm for support.
Hold law enforcement responsible for their poor efforts in this investigation while a ruthless killer targets innocent witches. Justice will be swift, kindred and allies. We'll fight to ensure it.
Janus appeared so childlike and eager at that promise. Then the TV switched off. Behind them, their mom stood there with the spare remote in her hand.
What have I told you about watching that nonsense?
Clarissa often used the word nonsense and her ex-husband's name interchangeably, which always, always, always set Janus off. Venus bit her bottom lip hard, bracing herself for the explosion.
It's not nonsense, Janus said, jumping to her feet. There's a killer out there, hunting down witchers, and the police don't care at all. Wasp wants to change how humans treat us. Why is that such a bad thing? How can you shoot down something you helped?
Two bolts of ire lit up Venus's insides, clashing together. The battle made her body a battlefield. Her heart punched and her blood incensed.
That's enough, Janus!
Clarissa snapped, her tone vicious and eyes bright with authority.
Fighting against the system is like going against a house of cards. The deck will always be stacked against you.
Tyrell jerked awake, his brow wrinkling deep in confusion. Instinct pushed Venus to stagger before her sister to act as a shield. Janus flinched, her boldness shrinking back. Her anger gave way to a spike of fear, a point that drove itself into Venus, making her grimace. Uncle Bram threw his hands up defeatedly, casting his sister a disappointed glance before he walked away. Clarissa composed herself, pointing to the hallway.
I think it's time for you to rest in your room. You've had quite a long night. Your sister and I need to handle business.
Even if the deck stacked against me, I refuse to fold,
Janus retorted, storming out of the room.
As I was saying earlier, we're out of burner phones. You need to make a store run,
Clarissa informed coolly, peeping at her wristwatch purchased with blood money.
You have little time, so I suggest you hurry.
Venus clenched her jaw, watching her mom return to the kitchen.
What the hell's going on?
Tyrell asked, rubbing the sleep from his eyes.
Doesn't matter, Venus said. It's over with now.
Chapter 2. A quote from Khalil Robinson, CEO of Bristol Audio,
excerpt of a 2019 commercial.
Bristle isn't just a Witcher-friendly rideshare app. Its existence is an ongoing protest against the Limit 12 law. We offer a safe, affordable alternative to public transportation. As the country's largest Witcher-owned employer, we pay our drivers fair wages and are 100% committed to their safety. Movement is progress. That's our motto. Join us for the ride.
To survive the outside world, Venus needed to blend in, to be forgettable. She gazed into her vanity's mirror, fixing her chestnut wig's blunt bangs. Always striving for perfection, she hoped no one noticed, because getting caught meant ending up like her father, dead. Childhood photos outlined her mirror frame. She stared at the one of her dad and a one-year-old her sitting on his shoulders. He grinned with all his teeth while she giggled with all of hers. Venus didn't inherit his deep dimples, but she had his amber eyes. In the picture, her pair and his radiated with warmth, a warmth that petered out as she lived on. Her mom took the photo mere days before her dad got killed for breaking the law, the Limit 12 law. To Witchers, Darius Knox was a legend, but to Venus, he was nothing more than a cautionary tale of what happens when you give too much of a fuck. Her sister meandered in and flopped down on the unicorn-themed bed with outstretched arms. Janus took in a deep breath and then sighed it all out.
I'm sorry for being a bitch earlier. I know you do what you do for us, for the family.
Venus reached for a comb to tame any unruly strands. It's cool. You had a long night.
I didn't have enough coffee, shit happens.
It was only a matter of time before someone offered an olive branch. Neither could ever stay mad at the other for long.
Now that all's forgiven,
Janus began in a sing-song voice,
you need to come with me to this Aurora's party on Friday.
Venus stiffened, then unscrewed a tube of magenta lipstick. I think I'll pass.
Come on, V. It'll be so much fun. Ty's coming too.
Janus whined, clasping her hands together in a plea. Only born a few days apart, Venus and Tyrell were inseparable growing up, causing a lot of hell, headaches, and eventually hangovers. As soon as Janus could, she followed behind them like a little duckling. Once, their mom never cared if they went to parties as long as they never went alone. But these days, she didn't care if they left solo, in a pair, or a trio, as long as they made it back home by morning, half dead or alive. While her sister felt at home at parties, Venus had good reason to be a homebody. She always needed her wits about her, which meant no more alcohol to forget or trysts to remember. Though she hadn't lost her taste for boys and girls, she wasn't about that life anymore. For everyone's sake, she couldn't be. Home was her fortress and her bomb shelter. She'd never forgive herself if something happened to her little sister or big cousin. She'd never forgive it. Then again, it didn't starve for her forgiveness or approval. It hungered for something much worse. Venus squeezed her eyes shut, clenching the silvery tube.
Don't think about that,
she inwardly urged herself.
Just say you'll think about it. 5 days is plenty of time to change your mind.
Janice's words reeled her out of her own head, her distress reflection greeting her. A trail of magenta clumsily veered off the roadmap of her lips, smearing over her silver septum ring. She erased the mistake with a tissue.
I'll think about it,
Venus promised. But don't get your hopes up. Janus squealed giddily, flailing her limbs all over the place. A fine example of getting one's hopes up. I didn't say yes. Venus crumpled up the tissue. She threw it at a bejeweled wastebasket at her feet and missed. She resisted the urge to solve the matter with a tiny pinch of magic. Instead, she kicked the stained wad underneath her vanity. Out of sight, out of mind. As a brewer, she lived by a code. One rule required her to swear a vow of abnegation to conserve her well of magic, a time-worn tradition to increase a brewer's odds of surviving a potion's degree of recoil. It stoppered most magic not used for brewing, but it wasn't leak-proof or without its cracks. The vow couldn't stop something like a premonitory dream or prevent her from being stalked by negative moods. Magic sometimes seeped in or bled out. While Venus tried to seal up the cracks with reinforcement potions so her deviation wouldn't escape, the negative emotions of others pursued her. As magic gave and took, the scales were often lopsided. There is no such thing as a win-win solution with magic. A little win, then a lot of lose.
You didn't say yes now, but you will.
Janice said it so matter-of-factly that Venus wondered if her sister dreamed a glimpse of the future. She reapplied the rich hue and smoothed her lips. If you know I'll go, why even bother asking?
I was trying to be polite.
You're doing a marvelously shitty job at it, Venus teased, rolling her eyes.
That should still count for something, though.
Plus,
Janus propped up on her elbows, batting her eyelashes dramatically.
How can you say no to a face like this?
Venus snorted a laugh. It's easier than you think.
But you won't, because you love me.
The word love rolled off her sister's tongue like a sweet song. Depends on the day. A flying pink pillow smacked Venus's back. They both broke into a fit of loud laughs, which eventually died down to close-mouthed giggles. Moments like these operated on borrowed time. In the Stoneheart household, time was money, and their mom was the timekeeper.
Remember when we were little and pretended to live in a cottage in the woods?
Janus asked softly, situating herself against the mountain of pastel pillows.
Of course,
Venus said. She thought about their childhoods often, an era where it didn't exist yet. In their tiny-ass backyard, a dirty yellow playhouse stood, a historic monument of their youth. Uncle Bram built it himself as a housewarming gift. Back then, they pretended to be enchantress sisters living contently in a magical cottage to feel alive. Nowadays, feeling alive meant doing illegal shit that could potentially kill them.
I want that, V.
Janus snuggled her cheek against a penguin plushie.
I want to run away and live in a cottage deep in the woods, just you and me. We'll be wild.
Venus plucked a pair of dark shades from her vanity, slipping them on. Her mind swelled with daydreams of them dancing madly with wild animals around blazing campfires, picking juicy berries and swan diving from waterfalls.
We'll be wild,
she agreed, liking how the promise tasted on her tongue. Like a coin, DC had two sides, an illusion and the truth. The illusion was what the world knew best. The crisp white monuments of supposed heroes and hope stood tall. The museums worshipped human victories and mistakes. A downtown brimmed with grand hotels, high-end stores, and trendy joints where the wealthy reigned, the tourist roamed, and the poor never rested. On the battlefield of Capitol Hill, lies and promises were cherished weapons, and the White House was nothing more than a poisonous time capsule of good old American dreams. Then there was the truth.
neighborhoods living in the shadow of illusion. There lived dreamers and those who didn't even bother anymore. A haven for no-gooders, unconventional achievers, the forgotten and the downtrodden. These streets were her home. Venus drove a few blocks over, parking at the corner pharmacy where her aunt worked as a cashier. Faded ad posters of liquor brands, cigarettes, and candy blanketed the dirty windows like a paper quilt. Black bars protected the pharmacy, but the metal wasn't iron. A silvery bell above the door jingled as she entered. No one occupied the front checkout counter or the pharmacist's window. She got two prepaid cells from between displays of baby medicine and condoms. Mr. Davids, the resident pharmacist, reclaimed his post. Aunt Keisha invaded the aisle she was in.
Already getting into trouble, I see,
she tisked at Venus. Her emerald nose piercing and the gold cuffs in her box braids glinted. A playful light touched her amber eyes, too, twinning a spark always found in every photo of her twin brother Darius. It became apparent that her aunt was stressed when Venus smelled cigarette smoke. She trailed behind.
I am trouble. Definitely a familiar trait,
Aunt Keisha replied, her smile sad and her dimples shallow as she rang up the items, putting them in a crappy plastic bag. Sometimes Venus liked to take inventory of her aunt's face, itemizing features her dad had too, as if it'd help her understand him better.
How's my troublemaker of a son?
The question caught Venus off guard, bringing her back to reality. Getting plenty of beauty rest on our couch, she answered, paying in cash. Aunt Keisha relaxed at the news.
Tell him, just because he's 18 now, don't mean he's too grown to return his mom's calls. He listens to you.
Because I don't yell at him, Venus wanted to say. Instead, she said,
must be my charming personality. Say you will.
Aunt Keisha held out the bag of goods.
I know shifting is painful for him, but if he refuses to practice, it'll backfire on him.
I'll talk to him, Venus promised. She opened the stubborn plastic packaging in the car and programmed each cell's number into the other's contact list. Being a bristle driver was the perfect cover for handling business. No open invitations for witnesses or trouble. She drove to Columbia Heights, a neighborhood in the city's northwest quadrant. Once a thriving Witcher homestead, gentrification pushed everyone out. All that was Witcher-owned became Witcher-friendly. It sent a very clear message to Witchers that they could visit, but could not stay. Venus parked outside the hideout, a hidden gem in this tiny part of the world. The Witcher's welcome sign dangled proudly on the door. A digital counter hung from a window, keeping a tally of the Witchers inside. To the naked eye, humans and Witchers were indistinguishable, but a Witcher's blood naturally ran hot at 108.6 degrees Fahrenheit, a biological fact humans exploited when they developed government-mandated heat sensors. Venus used the cafe as a neutral location to pick up prospective clients. Her mom had formed a partnership with Techie, a human ex-bouncer, now barista, putting himself through college as a tech major. For a cut of the profits, he did pat-downs and confiscated cells to use as a bargaining chip. The Witcher Crime Task Force, the mother department of SWIG, had become increasingly clever in busting illegal Witcher operations through hacked phones on undercover agents.
Right on time,
Venus said, as a purple tack popped up on her Bristle apps map. The Bristle dashboard light turned on as she accepted the gig. A bespectacled old man barged out of the cafe. He piled inside her car with a reddened face, hacking into a handkerchief. Techie watched from inside the cafe with a smirk.
Your friend has a rude attitude and very rough hands.
Mr. Mouse huffed breathlessly, shoving the cloth into his pocket.
He also took my phone.
I'll remind him to use moisturizer next time, Venus said, regarding the man in the rearview mirror. His face soured at her humor. Then he, too, looked at her. His anger crumbled away, disbelief widening his eyes.
You're just a child.
I'm old enough to vote and drive a car, she said, and enlist in the military if she were human. She turned 18 4 days ago and graduated from high school shortly before that. Mr. Mouse frowned, adjusting his glasses.
You're still a child. Is this how the Love Witcher conducts her business? Heavy-handed cavity searches in cafe bathrooms and teenage drivers to chauffeur her clients.
Venus eased the car back into the flow of traffic. I am the Love Witcher, Mr. Mouse.
You're not the woman I spoke to on the phone last night.
His mistrust grew with every word that fell from his lips. Did the woman you spoke with last night call herself the Love Witcher? An unspoken thought flickered across his face, and he calmed himself, casting his eyes down in defeat.
No, she didn't.
I apologize for the misunderstanding, Mr. Mouse, Venus said. She's my secretary of sorts. She takes all my calls and arranges all my meetings. The truth felt like a lie. Clarissa Stoneheart was nobody's secretary. She was the boss.
That doesn't negate the fact you're a child.
He shook his head. Don't mistake my age for inexperience, Mr. Mouse. Only a handful of brewers live in D.C. Yes, they're older and more experienced, but they have dedicated themselves to other disciplines. Mr. Mouse voiced impatiently.
What's the difference? A brewer should be able to brew any potion if given the right recipe and ingredients.
A brewer could never be a master of all potions. Only a single discipline. Health, trickery, powers, and luck were the known few in an endless list of disciplines a brewer could pledge to. But dabbling in another discipline meant breaking a pledge. And breaking a pledge meant forfeiting all magic. A choice her mom made. But sometimes, Venus wondered what life would have been like if her mom hadn't broken her pledge for a bag. A brewer's discipline was a calculated decision, often based on tradition. Venus came from a bloodline of love brewers. Her mom, a stringent instructor, taught her the lessons. Stonehearts before her once learned themselves. A pediatrician and a brain surgeon start out in medical school before they pick their respective fields. But you wouldn't ask a pediatrician to perform brain surgery, would you? She asked, used to this lack of faith in her talent. I was taught by one of the best master brewers in the world. It wasn't a lie to give the man some comfort. Mr. Mouse scoffed.
Then why can't she do it?
Her lips pursed in annoyance, her grip tightening on the steering wheel. Do you know the punishment for possessing a potion with the intent to give, Mr. Mouse? It's 5 years. And do you know the punishment for giving a potion to someone, regardless of said person's knowledge? 10 years. Brewers get 15 to life for brewing and selling. She flipped the wig's tresses over her shoulder to flash him a bitter smile. It doesn't matter who brews your potions, Mr. Mouse. If we're both caught, we both go to prison. No. If she thought he'd jeopardize her anonymity and freedom for a single moment, his prison would be a cold slab at the morgue. His sentence, courtesy of a bullet. The old man paled, his jaw quivering. She enjoyed how small and powerless he looked in her back seat. Do you understand that, Mr. Mouse? She asked, driving into a car wash. He nodded nervously, then stuttered.
Why are we here?
she selected the ultra-supreme, squeaky-clean option, feeding the menu machine a $10 bill. This car wash is 7.5 minutes. That's plenty of time for you to tell me what you need so I can tell you what I need. No more, no less. Afterward, I'll take you back to the hideout, she explained, readying the car. As the session began in the dark tunnel, she said, state your case, Mr. Mouse.
I need a love potion,
he answered, his voice jittery and rushed as if he heard the ticking sound of a countdown clock. For
someone who no longer wants anything to do with me.
You need to be more specific, Mr. Mouse. Venus examined her tangerine orange nails, pondering which color to paint them next. He blurted out,
my son! He despises me for the things I've done. Hell, I hate myself for the things I've done. I was an accountant with a gambling problem, debt piled up, and the loan sharks wanted their money, but I lost everything, so I left. I abandoned my wife and 9-year-old son like a coward. It took years to build a life elsewhere, but I made money the honest way and made wiser decisions. Over the years, I've tried to reconnect with him, but he refuses. I want his forgiveness. I want to be the father I should have been for him while I still can.
Venus sieved through his sob story, pulling out the only valuable nugget of information she needed.
You want stores?
Mr. Mouse blinked, his brow wrinkling.
What?
Love operates on a spectrum of 8 kinds. Stores means familial love, and I can brew you a potion for that, she guaranteed. An Eros potion induced lust. A Ludus potion encouraged uncommitted love, which was perfect for no-strings affairs and one-night stands. Agape potions were a popular choice for spouses in crumbling marriages. Mania potions drove a drinker to make the culprit their object of obsession. A Philia potion restored friendships. Sometimes she got clients who wanted Philautia potions to learn how to love themselves again. But her most demanded product was her Peito potions, to incite a drinker's love for an idea. Though Venus had the knowledge and skill to brew every type of love, her mom taught her which might bring her trouble and which wouldn't. Too eagerly, Mr. Mouse asked,
how much would it cost for this storage potion?
It depends on how strong you want the potion to be, she responded. The number of notes a potion has determines the strength and expiration date. The more notes, the longer it lasts. But very few potions last for life, and none are in the discipline of love. The more notes, the more devastating the degree of recoil, she refrained from saying. Most clients didn't give a fuck about a brewer's suffering. Singular note potions are 10,000, binary note potions are 20,000, and trinary note potions are 50,000, she informed. Mr. Mouse gawked.
$50,000 for one potion?
50 is a fair price, Venus said, shrugging. He threw his hands up.
How generous!
Time is running out, Mr. Mouse, she said, as the car progressed through the hectic tunnel, nearing the light at the end.
Fine! I'll buy the binary note potions, he said hurriedly.
A rush of satisfaction flooded her veins, but she remained stoic. Do you have 20 grand?
Do I have a choice?
Mr. Mouse bit out. Her lips quirked up at his attitude. What a feisty mouse. She handed over the burner phone and its charger. As the car wash session drew to a close, she instructed, you have 5 days to bring me the money. I was kind enough to set the alarm for you. There's one on my burner, too. If you haven't contacted me back before the alarms go off, everything we've spoken about in this car becomes null and void. I'll dispose of my phone, so you'll have no way of contacting me. Don't bother crawling back to Prospero, either. He won't help you. However, if you get the money, text me the word done and nothing more. I'll text you the next steps. Is that understood? As the car wash's fan roared to life, Mr. Mouse shouted,
yes, I understand!
The ride back to the hideout was silent, but his palpable anxiety buzzed in the air, vibrating against Venus's skin.
Eager to escape, Mr. Mouse reached for the door handle.
Oh, and Mr. Mouse?
She spoke up, prompting him to halt nervously.
I won't fault you if you can't come up with the cash or decide to not go through with this, she said, eyeing him over her shoulder. However, I've got some trust issues, so to ensure you don't try anything silly, like scurry off to the WCTF, my barista friend has a knack for hacking into phones and finding all sorts of yummy data. Just keep that in mind, okay? His entire body stilled, his face draining of color. He gazed at her wide-eyed and terrified, as if he were truly seeing her for the first time.
Your cell is waiting for you at the cash register.
She flashed him a sweet smile. Mr. Mouse gulped hard and exited the car, scampering inside the hideout. The corner of her lips curled up as she drove away. Chapter 3. An excerpt from Witchopedia, an online witchery encyclopedia. Iron is a witcher's mortal enemy. A whiff leads to respiratory illness. Witcher skin burns when touched. A taste is fatal. Iron skin, also known as liquid gold, is a trinary note potion that gives the drinker immunity. Iron, as an ingredient, further decreases a brewer's low survival rate. As a highly desirable Class X prohibited magical concoction, its black market price is 7 figures. June 6th, 2023. As Venus sunbathed on a flamingo pink towel, she rested her cheek on her crossed arms. She relished summer days like this, when the sun hung high and her fucks to give were low. Behind closed eyelids, she enjoyed a rare sense of peace. The reinforcement potion she had downed 3 hours prior brought her a quiet mind. The brew's potency was robust enough to gag it. But that perk only lasted a couple of hours. Beyond that, its silence was its choice. Psychological warfare it used to keep her on edge. But her magic wasn't the only thing capable of spoiling a moment like this. Venus kept the burner phone in the back pocket of her shorts as the harbinger of bad news. Silence meant peace. An incoming text message meant sometime soon she'd bleed and more. But even that wasn't the worst thing that could happen.
How many more minutes until she comes and fucks up the vibe?
Janus drawled, occupying the beach towel to the right. She, as in their mom, Clarissa.
I'll give it 5,
Venus mumbled.
4.
Tyrell yawned as he lounged in a lawn chair to the left, draping a forearm across his brow.
I say 3 tops,
Janus wagered.
Y'all 2 want a bet?
Tyrell patted his pocket for good measure.
I'm broke.
Nope, Venus said.
You're always broke,
Janus grumbled at him before she addressed Venus, an audible pout staining her voice.
Oh, why not?
A lazy Venus dredged up the effort to pin her little sister with a knowing gaze over the rim of her sunglasses.
Because you'll bet if I'm right, you won't go to the Aurora's party, and if you're right, then I'd have to go. How could you have possibly known that, V? Did you break your vow of abnegation to read my thoughts?
Janus asked teasingly, hiking an eyebrow. Venus snorted at the absurdity. No, I'd never break my vow. You're just predictable as fuck. Janus gasped in offense, clasping a hand to her chest.
I'm not predictable.
Fine. She sighed, rolling onto her back to bake evenly.
You're consistent. That's much better. Hey! That's the same thing!
Janus elbowed her in the ribs, knocking free a bright laugh. Tyrell lifted his sunglasses, regarding his cousin sleepily.
What if I'm right? What do I get?
You get to say, I told you so,
Janus growled through her teeth as she entered a playful slap battle with Venus, whose belly ached from laughing harder. A grin split across his lips, and he put his sunglasses back in place.
I bet.
Venus! The brisk utterance of her name gutted her happiness, bleeding out every ounce of playfulness she gave into. Clarissa had arrived within 3 minutes, as Janus had speculated. Venus propped onto her forearms and twisted halfway to acknowledge their mother, stationed at the back door.
Yes, ma'am.
Inside, now, Clarissa ordered, waiting expectantly for immediate compliance. Venus rose and wiggled the waistline of her frayed denim shorts up over her hips to buy herself some time.
Tyrell thumped a fist to his chest twice in solidarity.
Sympathy softened Janice's face, but her cocky voice strutted into Venus's head.
I win.
I didn't bet,
she mouthed, smirking. Janice's pity wilted like a sun-overdosed flower, a bratty glare blooming in its place. Venus flicked her tongue out before she crossed the backyard, retreating into the house. She knew she was walking into a trap, but was uncertain of what kind until she clucked the medical box on the table.
We're low on reinforcement potions.
Clarissa sat and unclasped the box, extracting a blood-drawing kit.
Sit.
Venus claimed a seat and laid her arm on the table, accepting her fate. She kept her expression blank as a needle punctured her flesh. Crimson emptied into a bag while hate poured into her. She didn't hate needles. Needles were child's play compared to the suffering of a potion's recoil inflicted. She hated these moments. She felt more like another chore on Clarissa's to-do list than Clarissa's child. A single drop of the intended drinker's blood was all a brewer needed, but it was as if her mother didn't trust her blood enough to behave as an ingredient, much like her mother didn't trust her, much like she couldn't trust herself. Once done, Clarissa offered her a cotton ball and a roll of self-adhering elastic bandage. As Venus patched up the puncture, she studied the fattened bag.
I can take that to Elder Glenn's.
As a master brewer of health, Elder Glenn made all the reinforcement potions Venus drank daily and the mending potions she needed when a brewing broke her. He sold them dirt cheap to her mom due to a debt that was classified as
grown folks' business. I'll do it myself, like always,
Clarissa stated. Venus curled her bare toes, frustration sifting through her.
If I'm capable of having clients, I think I'm capable of handling my own blood.
If you think I'll go back and forth with you, you thought wrong,
Clarissa asserted.
I will deliver this to Elder Glenn, and you will go get the supplies for Mr. Mouse's order. Take your sister to help. Is that understood?
Her mother's irritation washed over her like boiling water.
Yes, ma'am,
Venus pronounced, a soft bitterness slinking into her tone. The Stoneheart sisters strolled along a route of cracked, uneven sidewalks as the sun beamed down on them, their brown skin glistening with a light coat of sweat. They were heading to Carter's Pantry, one of the few witcher-friendly grocery stores in the city. Her foul mood stuck like gum to her shoe after what had happened in the kitchen, and her nerves grated at Janus smacking loudly on gum that should have tasted like rubber by now.
You know, talking and walking makes walking less boring,
Janus grinned, playfully nudging her shoulder into Venus.
And I have the perfect conversation starter.
No, Venus said swiftly. Janus ignored the rejection, tossing her arms up and singing,
Friday's Aurora's party.
Venus groaned at the mention, her eyeballs rolling skyward. Janus bumped her shoulder again, causing her to veer off the sidewalk this time.
Come on, V. It'll be fun, just like old times. You, me, and Ty getting lit.
She batted her eyelashes, lacing her fingers and plopping her chin atop.
Knocking back pixie juice, getting high, and throwing it back until dawn. That's what summer is all about.
Like I told you before, I'll think about it. Now it was Janice's turn to roll her eyes.
You think way too much. You rarely go out unless it's something to do with your hustle. It makes no sense how you pay so many racks for those reinforcement potions and you don't trust them enough to go live your life.
Venus shook her head slowly at her sister's persistence. I didn't sign up for a lecture, Professor. Their stroll slowed to a halt in the grocery store's parking lot. Ahead, a pack of iron watchers gathered at the curb outside the main entry doors. Their hate barged into Venus, making her feel tight in her own skin. 23 years ago, a group of violent vigilantes founded the Iron Watch, an anti-witcher organization with the mission of arming the masses with knowledge and iron to protect their God-given human rights. At first, no one paid them any mind as they went door to door and occupied street corners and sidewalks, passing out printed propaganda. But inked words had meaning if one believed in them, and as the humans attempted to coexist with witchers as equals, an exploding population didn't want peace.
Nah, we'll come back another time.
She wagged her head, turning on her heel. Janice sucked her teeth, walking on.
If you're too afraid to go in, I'll go myself. Just text me what you need. The Iron Watch don't scare me.
Why are you so damn hard-headed?
Venus blew out her cheeks as she swirled back around. Her reluctant strides caught up to Janice, who beelined toward the main doors blocked by the Iron Watchers. She intervened quickly by grabbing her sister's forearm and dragging her toward the side entrance. Venus divided Iron Watchers into whiners, barkers, and biters. Whiners kept their hate secret, hiding behind the safety of their phones and computers. Barkers acted upon the hate, taking to the streets in gas masks with flyers to let the world know witchers were poison. Then there were the biters. Biters touched witchers with their iron jewelry to relish the sound of sizzling flesh and screams. They enjoyed the torment and suffering of witchers. Some even resorted to quicker solutions like guns stucked with iron bullets. Venus had no desire to learn if the Iron Watchers only feet away were all bark or bite. Janice wanted all of the smoke, though, that was certain. A human woman attempted to enter the store, but the Iron Watchers crowded around her, offering flyers and trying to pitch different causes. The word bill and the phrase ironing up hit Venus's ears as she took Janice into Carter's pantry. They passed through the heat sensors, two chimes filling the air. Red digits on the digital counters throughout the grocery store ticked to the numbers 11 and then 12. If any other witcher dared to enter after them, an alarm would trigger and alert the swigs to pay a visit. A nasty sort of visit. Venus released her sister's arm to grab a squeaky wheeled shopping cart.
Did you hear those bastards?
A sour-faced Janice planted her feet on the cart's lower tray, holding on as Venus steered to the seasonings and spices aisle.
I think they want Mr. Carter to iron up the store.
For business to iron up meant barring their windows and doors with iron. It meant switching automatic doors for ordinary doors with iron doorknobs. It meant iron decorations and furniture everywhere. Ironing up meant no witchers were welcomed. Jerome Carter had always been a human ally to witchers. Everyone regarded him as an old head who doubled as a national treasure, and the kind of baby boomer with a heart so big and warm and eclipsed the sun. His wife of 46 years, Florence, was the high witcher of the neighborhood's coven. Their deceased eldest, Owen, had inherited her witcher genes. Their youngest, Lamont, was born human, though. To iron up his grocery store went against everything he stood for, everything he was. Venus tossed cinnamon sticks, nutmeg, and cloves into the cart.
It wouldn't surprise me if he did,
she said, throwing in vanilla beans and Damiana next. Janus arched an eyebrow, leaning over the basket.
Why do you say that?
Because humans are predictable, Jay. She plucked a bottle of basil leaves off the shelf. The human woman the Iron Witchers cornered earlier overheard the statement, gawking at them, insulted. Venus and her sister shot identical smiles, giving wiggly-fingered toodly waves. The woman scoffed, marching around the corner. Once alone again, Janus grazed her fingertips across the shelved products.
So you've always felt Mr. Carter would iron up this place?
No. I meant the humans who make all the rules will force him to eventually. Venus clarified. They're the predictable ones. But who exactly will tell them it's wrong?
They know it's wrong, but they don't care who it hurts.
Venus shrugged.
Sounds about right.
Janus frowned, cocking her head.
Do you even care about any of this?
I try not to, she admitted.
Why? Why don't you care that humans hate us for existing?
Quite simply, Venus didn't want to end up like her father. She didn't want to be a face on a mural like the one of Owen outside. She didn't want to be a hashtag, a news segment, or a statistic. She wanted to live in peace, not rest in peace. What was so wrong with that? What do you want me to do, Jay? Go to one of those WASP protests where I'd get beat with iron batons and cuffed with iron shackles? Oh, that's only if the swiggers aren't trigger happy that day. Is that what you want?
No,
Janus said firmly, hopping off the shopping cart.
I want you to act like this world is worth saving.
Venus stopped pushing.
And what if I don't think it's worth saving?
What if all I want to do is watch this bitch burn down because there's no good left in it?
If that's what you think?
Janus began angrily, then composed herself, squeezing her fists as she continued in a softer, concise tone.
If that's what you want, then you'd be no different from that thing inside of you.
Their eyes latched onto each other, intense and unwavering. A woman eased her cart beside theirs, uttering a quick, "Excuse me," and reached past Janus to get a seasoning bottle. Her sister's words and anger stabbed her chest deep. A tightening, burning pain sparked and grew and grew and grew, but that didn't deter a wintry smile from dominating her lips.
"Well, thank goodness you have a caring heart that's big enough for the three of us."
You know what? I think I'll go get some soda.
Janus swirled on her heel, putting distance between them. Good idea. That'll help wash all that bitterness coming out of your mouth, Venus retorted.
At least I can get rid of my bitterness. Yours, however, is a personality trait.
Janus tossed the insult over her shoulder as she stalked away. Chapter 4. An excerpt from Witcherpedia, an online witchery encyclopedia. All beings emit invisible energy, called auras. It is part of the Witcher's birthright to gain insight into a being's species type or magic strength. Human auras are muted in color, quiet, and obedient. The auras of most witchers and familiars are polychromatic swirls, while the auras of deviants are black. Due to their similar auras, humanoid familiars, known as Agathians, are commonly mistaken for witchers.
Damn, she didn't have to drag you like that,
it said.
I'm really not in the mood right now,
Venus hissed, trucking across the store to get to the produce section. Her skin crawled from its scratchy laugh.
You're never in the mood.
I wish you'd get a full-time job instead of renting space in my head for free, she said, snatching up a package of fresh strawberries.
If you don't want me to rent space in your head, then let me out to stretch my legs.
That's a good one, Venus snorted, yanking off a produce bag from a holder stand.
I'm not playing games with you. I mean what I say.
She stopped in front of a display of Granny Smith apples. All you ever do is play games. Mind games.
Only when I have patience.
Is that what this is? This is you being patient with me? How kind of you.
I don't have to be. Being in captivity hasn't changed my nature.
So, you think you're an animal? The apple Venus picked up had a deep brown bruise on it. Her head shook at the coincidence because, in a way, her magic was like a bruise that would never heal. It severed its tone to a taunting whisper.
No, but I know you're a monster. Let's not forget I'm here because of you. You have no one to blame but yourself.
Humor bled out of her as its words, at its reminder. Venus stood there frozen, unsure of what to say or do. Suddenly, in her back pocket, the burner phone vibrated, nearly making her jump out of her skin. She put the apple down and pulled out the device to stare at Mr. Mouse's one-word text. Done. If only she could apply that word to the parasitic relationship between her and it. If only. She grabbed a bouquet of white tulips from an open-face refrigerator in the floral department. Flowers had an unspoken language, and each had something to say. White tulips represented a plea for forgiveness and a wish for a new start. Red roses were a symbol of passionate love. Sunflowers meant adoration. Receiving yellow hyacinths was a sign of jealousy, and geraniums insulted your intelligence. Potions had their own language, too, which made flowers the perfect ingredients. If Mr. Mouse wished for his son's forgiveness, and to mend their torn relationship, white tulip petals would help. At checkout, Venus typed out a text asking Janus where she was. As she went to hit send, the Iron Watchers entered the store. Their iron jewelry's pungent odor assaulted Venus, a hideous burn coating her nostrils and crawling down her throat, her watering eyes stung, tears teetering at the edge. The walls caged in the scent. Nearby, an employee hunched over and wheezed as he escaped through the staff-only door. Other witchers made similar escapes through the back of the store or out the side entrance. She felt the hot teeth of their fear sinking into her. It released a mocking sigh.
This will be very interesting. It's a shame I have to sit this one out because of that silly little reinforcement potion.
The last thing I needed was your help anyway, she said inwardly.
Do you think Janus would appreciate my help?
It purred. Dread socked her in the stomach at the mention of her little sister. A trembly thumb mashed the send button to that "Where are you?" text. Seconds later, dancing dots in a text bubble popped up. Janus.
I was in the restroom when folks ran in. I made a portal to the parking lot. Blood tether is going buck. I'm coming to get you.
Blood tethers bound two folks together so they could always find each other when trouble found them. When they were younger, Clarissa made them forge one. Venus texted a no as a blonde iron watcher approached her and the human cashier. Blondie wore an iron bracelet and an assortment of iron rings. Their proximity worsened her symptoms, leeching her strength. She worried her trembling legs would give out if she tried to run. Her heart lost rhythm, pounding hard against her ribcage. Blondie sized her up, his chin tilting down when his gaze reached her shoes. He knew exactly what she was. Venus couldn't hide the quivers running down her frame, the tears staining her cheeks, or her labored breath. However, when he offered the cashier a stack of scarlet flyers, Venus also knew what he was. A barker. Blondie's voice streamed out the gas mask's mouthpiece.
We'd like to leave some of these with the store for human customers to...
A sudden swing of the staff-only door revealed Mr. Carter. He marched their way, clapping his hands together once.
Unless y'all want to add handcuffs to your jewelry collection, the gas mask squad needs to vacate the premises immediately.
Protectively, he stood in front of Venus.
But sir, Blondie began, I said what I said. End of discussion.
Like a live wire, Blondie's anger crackled up her spine, each painful jolt echoing in her bones.
Witchers don't care about you or any of us humans.
Blondie growled, standing firm.
They could burn this place to ash once they've used you.
His buddies closed in. The scent of iron coiled its fingers around Venus's throat and squeezed, her eyes bulging behind her sunglasses. Black spots danced along the edges of her vision. She sucked in a tiny, desperate breath.
How much longer before you break?
It asked, amused. Not much. Mr. Carter propped his fists on his hips.
I'll give y'all until the count of three to leave, before I have you and your little friends arrested for trespassing, Zachary.
Zachary reared his head back in shock.
How did you? I've seen you here with your grandmama Betty, and if I'm not mistaken, that's her 1988 Pontiac Bonneville parked out front, ain't it, son?
Come on, Zach, let's go.
A brunette chick sneered. His friends grabbed his shoulders, pushing him toward the exit. Venus exhaled shakily as the iron's grip on her loosened.
Much appreciated. Have a lovely day,
Mr. Carter said. Relief jolted Venus as the last iron watcher left. Though the iron's pollution waned, mild tremors raked her hand. She curled her fingers into a fist. Venus found Janus leaning against Owen's remembrance mural on the store's front, chewing nervously on her nail. She got tackled into a tight hug and grimaced. The iron had taxed her muscles, leaving her sore as fuck.
I'm so glad you're okay.
Janus pulled back just enough to trace the outline of her inky black aura.
Are you okay?
Sometimes trauma snapped magic like a bone, and it healed all wrong, twisted and infected, making it hard to read a deviant's aura. Venus nodded, her smile weak.
I will be.
All she wanted was a bubble bath and to sleep for a week straight. Janus gave her one last squeeze before she stepped back.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.